Radio Shack, the company that you might know as Tandy, started out serving electronics nerds selling radio components. To grow their market, they quickly moved into finished computer electronics like hi-fi separates. Their venture into computing started the same way. The original TRS-80 was pitched to computer nerds, but as the interest for computing grew, they hoped to sell to the masses with the TRS-80 color computer, affectionately known as the Coco. It's a machine that, despite playing second fiddle to other more popular home computers in the 1980s, went on to have a surprisingly long life, spanning 10 years. And why did this computer have such an odd origin? This is the TRS-80 color computer story. Motorola were losing the battle for the personal computer market, a market that was growing exponentially, yet it was their CPU design that had helped it blossom. The MOS technology 6502 in the Apple II and the Commodore PET were an evolution of the Motorola 6800. Its creator, Chuck Peddle, kept trying to get Motorola to make a cut-price version. He eventually jumped ship to MOS Technologies and created the 6502. Motorola had made the biggest mistake in computing, well, at least up until that point. In 1977, the University of Kentucky College of Agriculture were looking for a cost-effective video terminal for farmers, ranchers, and others in the agricultural community to get easy access to data from remote locations. Not wanting to miss out on the computer revolution, Motorola won the contract to design the chipset and the device. A low-cost terminal that could display data over a telephone connection to a regular TV needed a cut-price CPU, so Motorola followed Chuck Peddle's advice, a little too late, and cost-reduced the 6800 as the 6809. It wasn't just cheaper, it actually improved on the 6800 and the MOS technology 6502, to be fair, with 16-bit arithmetic, multiplication, and other useful programming features such as improved interrupts. Video display would be handled by the 6847 chip that offered 8 colours, well, 9 if you included black, simple text, blocky graphics, but also high-resolution colour graphics up to 256 by 192 pixels. Motorola also produced custom ICs to make the terminal cheaper to produce at scale. Motorola and the University of Kentucky needed someone to produce and distribute this machine. Enter Tandy with their manufacturing facilities and stores that spanned America. They produced the Alamco AgVision terminal, but soon realized it could be sold as a general terminal for the masses using the new CompuServe online service. So Tandy also launched the Videotex terminal in 1980, which allowed access to news, weather, sports, entertainment, and financial information. You could send electronic mail, shop or pay bills, all through your regular phone connection by plugging it into the wall. This was the stuff of 1960s futuristic visions, finally imagined in the 1980s. Motorola designed a computer that not only worked as a terminal, but with a bit of memory as a feature-rich home computer. What's more, it had color, sound, and high-resolution graphics, features which were lacking on Tandy's 3-year-old TRS-80. Almost everything could be reused from the Videotex terminal, the case, the keyboard, everything really. The hole showing the red Videotex data LED was replaced with a badge that showed how much RAM was installed. There was no internal modem, but a new serial I/O port could be used to add a smorgasbord of accessories. To make it a useful computer, Tandy added ports for a cassette recorder, cartridges, and joysticks. This made it very similar to the Atari 400 and 800 and the Texas Instruments TI-99, and the feature set may have been influenced by these machines, given that Atari announced their computer 1.5 years before the TRS-80 color computer launched. At the end of July 1980, Tandy did a big reveal of not only the $399 TRS-80 color computer, but also the TRS-80 Model 3 business machine and the Go Anywhere TRS-80 pocket computer, a rebadged Sharp device. The existing TRS-80 plus monitor combo from 1977 was still available. The Coco, as it was nicknamed, had the same 4 kilobytes of RAM as the original TRS-80, but there was so much more: color, high resolution graphics, sound, and the ability to instantly load games through cartridges. Whilst you could connect it to your existing colour TV, Tandy were happy to sell you a matching 13-inch colour video receiver, really just another TV, for another $399. One downgrade from the 1977 TRS-80 though was the keyboard. It was reused from the Videotext terminal and it was a chiclet affair like that on the TI-99/4. There were games, of course, but Tandy were still pitching their computers as something that could pay for itself with programs such as Personal Finance. The main way Tandy thought users would run these programs was through cartridges, or program packs as they were called. There were 8 not that exciting titles at launch, plus a cassette recorder to store programs, joysticks, and memory to upgrade your 4 kilobyte machine to 16 kilobytes. You could add a printer, although they cost a lot more than the machine itself. If you added a modem and accompanying software, your new computer could double as a video text interface to access the online service CompuServe. In 1977, Tandy had been very protective over hardware designed to protect third-party hardware and software companies from profiting from their machine. By 1980, Tandy had relaxed this somewhat after seeing the success of companies like Apple, who had a completely open model. Some people questioned the TRS-80 name. This computer had nothing to do with the original model. It used a different CPU, a different architecture, and the software was totally incompatible. Tandy had apparently toyed with the idea of calling it the TRS-90, but by 1980 the TRS-80 badge was a brand like Realistic or Archer. The Coco came with 8 kilobyte Color Basic on ROM, licensed from Microsoft like the original TRS-80. It gave a good list of commands and allowed for simple sounds and blocky coloured graphics. If you wanted high resolution graphics, you'd need 16 kilobytes of RAM, but there were no basic commands to put those high resolution graphics on the screen. You'd have to manually manipulate the video memory using poke commands. A more realistic proposition was the extended basic upgrade that launched in early 1981. Unlike the original TRS-80, there wasn't a separate expansion box to support disk drives and the like. Tandy had by this time worked out that most expansion would be limited to program cartridges, a cassette recorder, joysticks, a modem, a printer, or a disk drive. Tandy ensured that there were connectors on the machine to connect all of these add-ons. Prices for computer accessories were quickly falling. The modem that connected to the serial port dropped from $200 to just $150. Printers became a lot more affordable in the 1982 catalogue. There was a 32 kilobyte RAM upgrade and the promised 5.25-inch disk drive. It plugged into the cartridge slot and up to 4 drives could be added. Tandy had also promised business software such as word processing and a port of the VisiCalc spreadsheet program, but they were very slow arriving. Maybe not a bad thing, as Tandy would rather sell you an expensive VisiCalc-equipped TRS-80 Model 2 business machine. Instead of business software, the Coco got an expanded range of home software, mainly games, but also edutainment programs such as Bingo Math and a typing tutor. 3 years later, the Coco hadn't changed much. The $399 model got a 16 kilobyte upgrade, although you'd still need to pay $100 for the extended BASIC ROM to access high resolution graphics from BASIC. But outside the curated world of the Radio Shack store, where only Tandy products were sold, a full-scale computer price war had broken out. $399 looked ridiculous when the Texas Instruments TI-99 and Commodore's VIC-20 could be had for a quarter of the price, and they had a full travel keyboard. Or there were computers like the Commodore 64 and the Sinclair ZX Spectrum that offered more, like more basic commands, and in the case of the Commodore 64, more colours and better sound. Tandy's answer to the cut price competition launched in 1983 as the MC-10. Under the hood, it was pretty much the same as the original Coco: 4 kilobytes of RAM, simple color BASIC, blocky graphics and sound, all repackaged into a small case with chiclet keys, all for the low, low price of $120. This made it a better deal than the bare-bones Sinclair ZX81 Timex 1000. It was able to run much of the Coco software, but only from cassette, no disk drives or program packs for you. The edge connector on the back was used to upgrade the memory or connect to Tandy's new budget printer. The MC10 was offered in France as the Matra Alice, but by 1983 customers were looking for better graphics and sound. Despite the price, both machines failed, the MC10 being withdrawn after only a year. The Matra Alice didn't even make it beyond the year it launched. The original Coco kept selling, now using the cost-reduced chipset that made the MC10 so inexpensive. And Tandy allowed RCA to sell a version of their computer as the TDP-100. By 1983, there was more software, mainly games. The proprietary Scriptset word processor arrived on both cassette and disc, but the Coco's keyboard wasn't really suited for long sessions typing.
This year, I needed to give a real family pleaser.
Honey, please help me with this budget.
How about a new game, Dad? Please?
And I found it. Radio Shack's Color Computer 2.
Tandy gave the original Coco a small update in 1983 to keep it competitive with their latest home computers. The cost-reduced chipset and lower chip prices meant that for the same $399 price of the entry-level Coco 1, the new computer had 64 kilobytes. A 16-kilobyte model could be had for $320. If you didn't want high-resolution graphics, there was a 16-kilobyte basic model for just $240. Other than the deletion of the 12-volt rail on the expansion connector, the new computer was pretty much the same as the original Coco and could run the same programs from tape, disc, or program pack. There was a new multi-pack interface that allowed up to 4 program packs to be connected, useful as cartridges could be installed whilst leaving the disk drive permanently attached. There was even a mouse, quite novel for 1984, advertised for playing games or creating color graphics. Microware wrote OS 9 for the Motorola 6809 in 1979, and the popularity of the Coco and Tandy's more relaxed attitude to third-party software developers meant that it was ported to the TRS-80 color computer, allowing for multi-process operation. For example, one process could take keyboard input while one communicated through the serial port to a modem, and some people used it for their own private bulletin board services. These were good upgrades, but the Coco was starting to show its age. There were still only 9 colours, no lowercase letters, only 32 columns of text, an inferior sound to the Commodore 64. Some of these problems were addressed in 1985 with an update to the video display chip that included lowercase letters. The computer also got a name change, the Radio Shack TRS-80 Color Computer 2, quite a mouthful, became the Tandy Color Computer 2. By 1985, there were even lower prices. The 64 kilobyte model was now just $260, and you could get the entry-level machine without high-resolution graphics for $120, the same price as the 4 kilobyte MC10 a couple of years earlier. Tandy were, of course, happy to sell you a bundle deal with disk drives, a colour TV, and a printer for $1,100. There were other peripherals, like a touchpad. It seems software was selling well as there was a double-page spread for games, productivity apps, and even Disney-branded edutainment. On the next 2 pages were other peripherals, such as home automation and a speech synthesizer. Tandy was also still selling the CompuServe bulletin board service and modems. There was even the original agricultural data service that had started it all, still providing vital updates to farmers. In 1986, the 64 kilobyte model was down to $220, but Tandy had an update in the works, and it was more than the 1983 small refresh. This was really needed. After all, the 16-bit Atari ST and Commodore Amiga had launched a year earlier. The new Tandy Color Computer 3 got a new graphics chip, the Gimme, that offered 16 colors out of a palette of 64 with much higher resolution graphics, 640 by 192. There were text modes up to 80 columns wide, meaning that with a full travel keyboard, productivity software like word processors and spreadsheets were a more practical proposition, so long as you bought a disk drive which cost more than the machine itself. There was even a GUI desktop available to purchase Deskmate, although it only offers simple features like a calendar and a calculator. 640 by 192 graphics and 80 column text would be impossible to read on a TV, so the Coco 3 supported color monitors, and Tandy were of course happy to sell you one. memory also got a boost thanks to paged memory management. The 8-bit Coco 3 that should max out at 64 kilobytes came with 128 kilobytes expandable to 512. Extended BASIC was further extended to support the computer's new features, although without its author, Microsoft. The Redmond-based software company were far too busy churning out DOS updates as the PC took off, so the new BASIC features would be written by Microware, the people who produced OS 9. So as not to violate the Microsoft licensing agreement, the original ROM would be loaded into RAM and then patched with the Microware updates, and in the process, Microware also introduced some bugs, which wasn't too great. Anyway, when combined with the processor that can run twice as fast as the Coco 2, this represented a genuine boost in power and good value at just $220. But whilst it might have graphics similar to the Atari ST and the Commodore Amiga, that processor couldn't hope to compete against the Motorola 68000. It was common for Tandy to keep selling the old model to get the most revenue out of it, to sell to customers who'd already bought one and wanted another or wanted a replacement, and also to hedge their bets in case the new machine wasn't a hit. So the Coco 2 64KB model with high resolution graphics and the same full travel keyboard as the Coco 3 was still on sale for $160. It was even more affordable in 1988 at only $100. But whilst the Tandy Color Computer continued on sale in North America, it ran up against fierce competition in Europe, and the Coco 3 was never released there. It probably didn't help that there was another computer based on the same Motorola reference design, the Dragon 32 and 64 that had launched in 1982. The Coco got additional peripherals, the Orchestra 90cc that offered a better sound chip, a hard disk interface to help this computer compete in the small business market, and a wide range of software. The Coco might be useful for some business applications, but IBM PC compatibles ruled the office, and Radio Shack devoted a lot more space in their catalogue to selling you one of those. The range of PC software was vast, and the Coco could never hope to compete. That didn't stop the Color Computer 3 from continuing to sell as a budget machine. In 1988, it had dropped to $200, and it remained on sale at that price until October 1990, when Tandy announced its discontinuation. That was still good value when a Commodore 64C with worse graphics and less memory cost only a little less, and the Amiga was three times the price. And when blinged up to the max with memory, the very capable OS 9 software, disk drives and a hard drive, it made for a very potent combination. It's clear with the Color Computer, Tandy learned that they needed to encourage third-party hardware and software companies, but compared to companies like Apple and Commodore, it wasn't enough. Customers inevitably gravitated to products like the VIC-20 and the Commodore 64 that had a much larger selection of peripherals and software. The Coco looked inferior with Tandy joysticks and Tandy software when it was compared to the Commodore 64 with the latest must-have game and ergonomic joystick that were being shown at your local department store. But Tandy didn't make the mistake Texas Instruments made by starting a price war that no one was going to win. They lowered their prices, yes, but they were sure to always make a profit. After all, why should they lose money? If a product in their lineup failed, just sell more hi-fi separates off the back of a motorbike or a cordless telephone. That's why Tandy were happy to sell PC compatibles next to the Color Computer. They would sell whatever the customer wanted. So at the same time Texas Instruments were taking a massive loss over their TI-99 computer, Tandy saw profits in their stores grow by 35%. The TRS-80 Color Computer lasted an amazing 10 years, an eternity for the 1980s home computers. It showed it was a well-designed product that got useful updates throughout its life. Those updates made it a practical tool for the home or the small business, and it's a well-loved machine by those who cut their computing teeth using one. But whilst it sold well, the next major home computer to hit the market left more of a lasting impression, Captain Kirk's VIC-20, and that will be the subject of the next video. When the VIC-20 video is ready, there'll be a link to it on the right, or if you want to see a video on Tandy's first machine, the TRS-80, there's a link to that as well. Thanks for watching to the end, and I'll see you in the next video.